Good morning. My name is Martin Rauchbauer. I'm the director here at Deutsches Haus, and I want to welcome you back to our second day of the conference on the Berlin School. The State We Are In is the title of our two-day conference, and this is the first of a series of three conversations we're going to have throughout the day. There is also a catalog that MoMA produced, a wonderful catalog that you can buy for the special price of $20 at the reception throughout the day, and I wanted to mention that as well. And I'm going to introduce to you very quickly the two filmmakers and the moderator of our first panel. Thomas Arslan is one of the three founding directors of the so-called Berlin School. He's a professor now for narrative film at the Berlin University of the Arts. He studied German philology in Munich from 1985 to 1986, but soon moved on to the German Film and Television Academy, the DFFB in Berlin, where he studied directing. I'm only going to mention the three films that are shown at the MoMA show, which is Brothers and Sisters, Geschwister, then Im Schatten, In the Shadows, as well as Gold, his latest film. And then Benjamin Heisenberg, he studied sculpture at the Academy of Fine Arts and subsequently feature film directing at the Munich College of Television and Film between 1998 and 2005. In 1998, he founded the film magazine Revolver together with Christoph Hochhäusler, who we saw yesterday at the opening panel, and Sebastian Kutzli. And you can see Christoph Hochhäusler and Benjamin Heisenberg on Monday at 7 o'clock at the MoMA discussing the Berlin School as well as the magazine Revolver. His award-winning feature film debut Schläfer, a complex thriller about love, career and betrayal in the words of the Süddeutsche Zeitung, premiered in the Cannes Film Festival section Un Certain Regard in 2005. His films include Milchwalch and Der Räuber, The Robber, which is seen here at the MoMA show. And I'm also very happy to welcome our moderator, the film critic Katja Nicodemus. She studied comparative literature, political science, Latin America studies, and Russian in Berlin and Paris. She worked in radio and television and made documentaries on film history before becoming a film critic at the prestigious daily newspaper, Die Taz, in 1999. And in 2003, she joined Die Zeit, the weekly German newspaper, where she has been working as a film critic for the Feuilleton, and she lives in both Berlin and in Hamburg, and she is going to lead us through this morning's conversation. Thank you all so much for coming, and I hope you will enjoy this day.
So first of all, I would like to say, for me, it's a real honor. Honor seems to be a bit random, but it's a real honor for me to be here because I've been following the films of the Berlin School from the very beginning. And in a way, as a film critic, I went to that school too. I grew up with those films, and for me, it's a real pleasure to see them presented here in New York and to see how well they are received. And yesterday, I wrote once again a wonderful text that you wrote in your film magazine, Revolver. In that text, you compared filmmaking to figure skating. And there's always, you write the compulsory part and there's the freestyle element. And so here, my little compulsory part is a very short introduction, and then I will get very quickly with you to the freestyle element, I hope. And it's really difficult to define the Berlin School, and I'm not going to do that because there are so many directors, styles, and approaches. But I think what unites you all is really a passion for cinema and for the history of cinema. And it's a very deep and passionate awareness of the fact that every image has a precedent, and you don't quote or you don't imitate your precursors, but you enter in a real dialogue with them. And you do that in very different ways. You teach at the Berlin University of Arts, and you are the co-founder, Benjamin, of Revolver, a film magazine. And for me, that magazine is especially fascinating because you don't have a journalistic approach. It's more a mixture between, let's say, workshop and dialogue with the Berlin School directors, but also with directors that you deeply admire, like Abbas Kiarostami, you did interviews with them, with Lars von Trier, with Jean-Claude Carrière. And so my first question would be, how would you two define your very own approach to film history, your way of entering into a dialogue with film history and also with contemporary films, but with other films?
For me, it's the way that I didn't plan to become a filmmaker. So I first thought I'd be a fine artist, kind of a sculptor or something like that. And filmmaking came about by trying to find narratives in sculpting, or how you call it. So that's how film history also came to me. It was like I was interested in narratives and in how people would tell stories in pictures, or in pictures following each other. So then I started, I'd seen a lot of films as a child, so on, but I never thought of them as film history. I just thought of them as something you consume and you like and you just enjoy. So then in the time when I was studying arts, I began to become interested in film history as a form of art in a way. So and then as film school wasn't as interesting as I had hoped, kind of, we didn't have that good education there. I had the feeling then we started to try to talk to the people that we found interesting. And that was in the beginning Lars von Trier and the people from Dogma and so on. So this is in a way how contemporary film came to us more closely or more intensely. So I can't really define it to certain moments in my life as a filmmaker, but it's been kind of a constant process.
Yeah, my way was pretty simple. I found my way to filmmaking through being a spectator. And when I have been 12, 13, I've been a fan of Bud Spencer and Terence Hill and so on. I saw everything in cinema, but not, at least in cinematographic terms, nothing special. So it was really a normal spectator these days, and when I've been, I guess, 17 or something like this, I explored a little film club in this little town I grew up, Essen, it was a filmmaker, Werner Biedermann. He made a little film club in this on a special place, and there had been 10 people, 15 people, and so on. But they showed films from Godard, from Eisenstein, and so on, and it really opened my eyes. And I had I was no big big an acknowledgement about cinema, at least nothing.
And how old were you at that time?
I guess 17 or something like this. I was not. I didn't make Super 8 films for 6 years like Tom Tykwer and so on. But I came very lately to the cinema, at least, to a bigger passion for cinema. And these kind of films opened my eyes, and I explored what could be possible in different ways I wouldn't say a language, because I don't think there's a straight film language, but it opened my eyes what is possible with film. So
maybe we should talk about some moments of revelation for both of you, because in Benjamin's film magazine Revolver, you wrote a text about. By the way, this text is published in the MoMA book about the Berlin School too. In the text you wrote about a film that you saw in 1983, I think, Maurice Pialat, A Nos Amours, and at that time you thought of yourself as a very experienced moviegoer, and then you saw that film in which Sandrine Bonnaire plays a young woman looking for her way through love and life, and when you saw that film, everything changed. So what happened at that time?
Yeah, it's a very special film for me because I was not really prepared for it for the films of Maurice Pialat. Said to me nothing these days, and it was the first time I saw him. It's not easy to talk about Maurice Pialat because these films are really special for me, and it shocked me in a way because yeah, it's at one hand they are very simple stories, but as a way how they told are even in cinematographic terms is really special. It's but without trying to be very artistic. So it shocked me in some ways, this film, but other films as well before, like Mouchette from Bresson or Pickpocket. It's this. There are some films which shocks you in a positive way. So and this is one of my favorite film.
C'est sorci qui rentre.
J'avais dit minuit.
Il est 1h.
Oh, c'est pas grave.
Qui c'est, ce garçon?
Quel garçon?
Écoute, tu me prends pour un idiot. Comment il s'appelle?
Bernard.
Bernard comment?
Bernard Trevis.
Qu'est-ce qu'il fait?
Son service militaire.
Qu'est-ce qu'il fait dans la vie?
Travaille avec son oncle. Puis vit chez sa grand-mère.
Tu comptes l'épouser?
Tu me vois mariée?
Bah, je sais pas, qu'est-ce que tu fais avec lui?
Mais quoi, je sors avec lui, c'est tout. Pas parce que tu sors avec un mec. Obligé de l'épouser, hein. T'as l'air crevé, toi. T'as pas de coucher?
Et toi, tu vas te lever encore demain, ça va être la corrida avec ta mère.
Ouais, je vais y aller. Je suis crevée. Bon, allez, bonsoir. Qu'est-ce que t'as à l'œil?
Qu'est-ce que j'ai à l'œil?
T'es tout jaune.
Tout jaune?
Je t'assure que t'es tout jaune.
Bon, ça va pas. J'ai le blanc de l'œil tout blanc, au contraire. T'as changé, hein, depuis quelques semaines, là. Je t'observe.
J'ai changé?
Oui.
En quoi j'ai changé?
Je sais pas. Tu souris plus beaucoup.
Moi?
Qui va pas?
Y a rien.
Ben, je sais pas, tu souriais au moins 10 fois plus que ça dans le temps. Et quand je dis dans le temps, c'était il y a 1 mois, 2 mois. Tu t'ennuies, on dirait.
Non, je m'ennuie pas. Je m'ennuie pas, mais... C'est toi qui mets les idées dans la tête.
Non. Et puis je te connais, là, têtu, bourrique comme tu es, tu liras jamais pourquoi tu...
Mais non, mais y a rien.
Écoute.
Je t'assure, y a rien.
Ça fait 1 mois environ que t'as changé.
1 mois?
Oui.
Et pourquoi tu l'as pas dit plus tôt, alors?
On se parle pas beaucoup.
Ouais, d'accord, mais c'est pas une raison. C'est toi, ouais, qui change. T'es tout triste, là.
Je suis pas triste, je suis fatigué.
Bah, t'as vu comment que tu bosses?
Je crois que je vais vous quitter, Suzanne.
Nous quitter?
Oui.
Tu vas aller où, alors?
Oh, ça me regarde.
Et nous, qu'est-ce qu'on va faire, t'y penses?
Mais, figure-toi que j'y pense, oui. T'auras ton frère. Un chef de famille, ton frère.
Un frère, ça suffit pas. Hein.
Tu vois, il y a un jour, on en a assez. C'est peut-être arrivé pour moi.
T'en as marre d'ici?
Bon, il y a un jour où on en a marre, oui.
T'es une bonne femme, c'est pour ça. Bah, si on part, c'est pour ça, hein.
Mais oui. Et ça te ferait quelque chose?
Bah, et comment?
Bah, que ça peut te foutre.
Bah, t'es quand même mon père, hein.
Bah, et alors? Je suis ton père, c'est tout.
Ouais, d'accord, mais... Je t'imagine pas qu'une autre bonne femme.
Bah, je t'ai rien dit, hein.
Ouais, d'accord. Je t'imagine pas partie non plus.
Eh ben moi, tu vois, ce soir, je t'imaginais avec Bernard Trévy.
Ah bon?
Ben oui. Pourquoi tu crois qu'on n'a pas d'imagination quand on est parents?
Si.
Ton Bernard Trévy, t'en as pas marre, là?
Ben non, je serais pas ici, sans quoi. Enfin, je serais pas avec lui.
Ben, parce que t'es avec lui.
Non, mais... Ben, j'aurais pas été au cinéma avec lui, quoi.
Tu trouves pas ça bizarre que les parents, les enfants, ils veulent jamais parler de ça?
Parler de quoi?
Ben...
De...
T'en as plus qu'une. Elle est partie quand l'autre? Non. Là, t'avais
pas.
Deux fossettes avant.
Ouais, j'en avais deux, je sais.
Et pourquoi l'autre, elle est plus là?
Je sais pas. Elle en avait marre, elle aussi.
Ouais.
Elle est partie.
Tu te rends compte, regarde, on vit avec quelqu'un tous les jours, je m'en étais même pas rendu compte. En fait, t'as pas t'en faire, hein. Avec celle qui reste, t'es ratiche, comme tu dis, t'es ratiche.
Ouais.
Tu t'en sortiras, mais il va te toucher. Hein.
Allez, bon, ça. Une fois qu'on a bien parlé, tiens. Salut.
Salut.
Well, I didn't want to shorten the scene because you really have to see the ending. and she's so young, isn't she? Thomas, in your films, you also are looking for strategies to capture reality, to capture life, to capture the very moment of your characters. And Maurice Pialat isn't a storyteller in a classical way, but he also follows his protagonist with the camera. And here, the scene feels like real life. And how does he get to that? Maybe you could say some words about the camera.
Yeah, it's hard to say, but. I think you saw that there's nothing special or really artistical brilliancy in the photography. There's no virtuoso kind of acting. He has no interest for this. This kind of cliches. What a good film might to be. So. He gives a lot of space to the actors, but of course he cares for the camera. You have to, of course. It would be naive to just do to shoot a scene in a thoughtless way, of course. But how could I say? Of course, it's a lot of. Cinematographic thinking is this kind of film, but he refuses all this so-called professional clichés to produce these kind of clichés of well-made cinema. It's on this level he doesn't want to impress anybody. And it's really focused on the persons and on the little moments, and he's very carefully he's handling this details very carefully, and that's the most important thing, and at least the most difficult thing. So it's the hardest kind of work to. Gets this kind of moment, and you have to take long detours, I guess, to a lot of work to find, if you're lucky, to find a scene or a moment like this. And I guess you have a great possibility to fail. And but that's interesting for me.
But what I find really interesting about the scene is that you. That it doesn't stop in a way. I mean, there's a lot happening in the scene, and I think it's a fantastically written scene. And there comes a point where you have the feeling that a lot already has happened in the scene, and with a film that's not as good as this one, the scene would just be over. But it just goes on and on and on, and they find new aspects about themselves and about each other. and it becomes richer and richer, and you notice so much stuff about their relationship that it's just absolutely fantastic. And the camera is so precise in being very close to them and then moving a little away again and coming closer, that I think it's really a masterpiece.
And I have the impression that what Thomas just said is very close to what you wrote in your text about the comparison between figure skating and making movies, because the compulsory element is not here. It's just freestyle, but you have to know the compulsory elements to get to that kind of freestyle, I think.
Yeah, and it's not only the scene does much more than what it would need for the film to function. I mean, for the film to function, the basic information is that this father is intending to move out. But the film does much, much more than giving this information. And that's what divides good and bad films, that you, through relationships and through this very deep insight in relationships, you get much more than just the basic information for storytelling. And that's what I was trying to say in this text, that kind of the basic element of figure skating is one thing, but kind of having the expression of the person and the expression of bodies, that makes figure skating in a way unique. And that's the same with film. If you really get a close view on the people and a feeling for what they are as persons, also for the actors as persons, I think that is something unique. And in most of the really good films, we get a lot, we see a lot about the actors and what they are as persons themselves, even if they're in the role.
Yeah, and when we come back to the dialogue with film history, you watch other films not to learn from the compulsory elements, but to get to their freestyle elements, I think, and otherwise you would just imitate them or quote them. And yeah.
Yeah, and you have so much time. I mean, if you see what the camera does, it just stays on the faces, and sometimes the view is obstructed. But in a way, you have so much time to watch these people that you really have the feeling to get to know these people, even if you wouldn't listen to what they were saying. And if we see what's done in commercial filmmaking today, where you have so much cutting and the camera is constantly moving around, that's in a way keeping you from having this sight on people. So I think this is something that is unique and great if you have that in filmmaking.
And you're not forced to identify with the characters, because it's both of them are main characters in the film. And you're not, as a spectator, you're not forced to anything, at least. So you have this kind of freedom to make your own thoughts, your own impressions, and but it's still a lot of feelings, of course. The whole film is full of feelings, but it's not connected to one person, to one scene, and it's not forced in this kind of narrative cliché. So it's very, very interesting for me. So.
And in the text, published first in Revolver and then in the MoMA book, you also write that this freestyle element has to reveal the most inner feelings and values of a filmmaker. And as a clip, you chose a clip from Andrzej Wajda's Ashes and Diamonds, I think from 1958. And could you give us a short introduction to the scene and also to what kind of freestyle of Wajda you see there?
Well, I mean, this film is something different. As we thought we'd also talk about genre, I thought I might take this scene from the film. It's a film that I've seen between 40 and 50 times. It's one of my favorites. And it has a very special way of storytelling, because it has a very symbolist style of storytelling. So I thought it'd be interesting to look at that. And it's what we're going to see is in the very end of the film, when the main character, who's kind of a resistance fighter, kills the guy he's supposed to kill. He's supposed to kill a communist guy. It's on the end of the Second World War. The film plays at the end of the Second World War, and the main character was a resistance fighter against the Nazi, and now becomes a resistance fighter against the communists. And it's this very complicated situation in Poland between the Nazis and the communists, between both of these regimes and the people who are trying to find out what their own position in this changing country is. So, but I chose this this end scene where he kills the guy, because I think it, in terms of genre, it's very interesting to look at that, because the film has very strong genre elements, and the main character was a big star in Poland because he has this very cool look and so on. He's a great actor, but at the same time, it's a very personal film, and it's a very, and it depicts in a great way a very complicated situation. So yeah, maybe let's have a look at it. What might be interesting is that he has these systems of signs in this film. There's always a very symbolistic way of showing stuff, and you always have stuff in the foreground of the picture, and then in the very deep ground, other things, and they're all depicted in the same sharpness, like in Citizen Kane, for example.
No i doczekaliśmy się pod naszą Warszawę.
Piękna jest noc, trzeba się przejść przed wyjazdem.
Co, pan już wyjeżdża?
Niestety, żonę mam zazdrosną.
Thank you.
it's very dramatic. It's also in terms of lighting and everything. But what I like about it is that it's so in very terms it's very simple in a way. You know, it's a scene of someone killing someone else, and it happens so quickly in a way. You have a very long preparation for it, and the whole film in a way prepares for it. And the main character is always torn between doing it and not doing it because he's fallen in love and so on. And in the end he does it, and it's with his fireworks, and it's also the end of the war. The fireworks are for the end of the war, so it's kind of a very emotional and comprimed moment in the film. Yeah.
When we talk about the patterns of the genre film, I mean there are 2 million ways to kill someone on screen, and the pattern is in a political thriller somebody has to be shot, and here we have some kind of Polish James Dean, and he will be dying on a trash heap. So I mean that is really, let's say, at the least you could say, a very uncommon genre movie.
Yeah, I mean it begins with the killing. The film begins with the killing where they're killing other communist people, and they seem to be very hardened by the war already. But then during the film you notice that they're people, and you also get to know the communist guy. You get to know him, and you see that the boy, you know, with the butterfly at the lamp, he's the son of this communist who's being interrogated and probably will be killed. So you see the different sides of the society and how they work or don't work with each other, and how this life has become very difficult in this country. But it's kind of very, very heightened in the way that it's depicted, which I kind of like. Also, the way of acting is not really totally natural, but it's kind of overacted and very, very expressive, which I find quite unique in a way he does that.
So before we go on, are there any questions already in the pub, in the audience, or no?
I just want to add this, that this is interesting for me as well. It's not, I'm not only as a spectator, I'm not only only preferring films like Maurice Pialat. It's a film from the same year, I guess, Touch of Evil from Orson Welles. It's one of my favorite films as well. So hyper-stylized, very, very typish characters, but it's really interesting. So there are so many options in cinema, I guess. At least they're not big rules, and yeah, that's interesting for a filmmaker to find a way, but on the other hand, you have to be open to explore new things and so on.
Yeah, and I think that if you look at the acting, it's interesting that we have kind of overacting in comedy. For example, we have that today. That's a normal thing we have. But in semi-realistic movies, this way of overacting is hardly seen. Or at least in Germany, if you do acting like that, people would say, oh my God, you know, it's badly acted and it's so unnatural. Whereas I have the feeling if the film is consistent in itself, then it makes totally sense, and it has a great effect on the viewer. You know, it's a great thing to experience. But there are now certain kinds of needs for acting, or people have established a certain kind of view on how acting should be in a realistic movie, which I find absurd in a way. Because probably we in our lives act as absurd as these guys very often.
You both have made genre movies, genre films. You made The Robber, a heist movie, and the political thriller, one could say Sleeper. You made a Western Gold and a gangster thriller In the Shadows. And I think once you said that the big challenge, Thomas, you said, is to make the patterns, to use the patterns of the genre film, to make the patterns touch a responsive chord in your own way. And what are those patterns to you? Are they allies, companions?
Yeah, it's difficult. it's on one hand, when you're going to make a genre film, I guess I would say that Im Schatten is more a straight genre film than Gold, because Gold is kind of, there are some genre elements in it, but it's not planned as a straight Western. So, but Im Schatten, of course, it's more offensive as a genre film. I would say, you're working with narrative patterns which everybody knows, the spectator knows, and which had been used many times before, but you have to find a way to create a kind of variation, and when you're using this kind of patterns, at first you communicate with the cinema itself. So, and that is this is interesting, but it's a problem as well, I guess. When you only communicate to the cinema or with the cinema, because I guess it's necessary for me. It's more interesting to open these kind of patterns in some way and to connect it to not real life, but to nowadays, to the world in some, and this is a difficult point and the interesting point for me to work with genre patterns. So.
Yeah, I think that if you look at both of our films, it's I have the feeling we both wanted to do genre films in a way. Yours is maybe more a thriller, mine in a way a mixture between a thriller and an action drama, whatever. I think you reacted to it because we don't have the money that a normal thriller of the kind of big budget size would have to do all the fancy effects that the viewer today is used to. So the answer to that in your part, I think, was kind of to really getting to the inner core of thrillers and to this genre. And my answer was kind of to try to find a way to tell an action scene with the little means that we have, kind of just focusing on one guy running and not having kind of all the seeing 200 police cars and whatever, because we can't afford 200 police cars. So and we can't afford 50 helicopters flying around. So we just focus on this one guy running, and we totally focus on his perspective. We don't have so many other perspectives to tell the story, and it's a choice which comes from for financial reasons, but also for artistic reasons, because you get across just another experience for the viewer. Because these days, when we watch these mainstream movies, the experience is more or less similar. Because we always have these patterns on how we look at action scenes, so that they become more and more spectacular. Whereas if we level down these views on action or on thriller, it might become much more interesting, because we have the very subjective view of one person, or we have the very subjective view of the storyteller, and we might get a glimpse on how more in your film, I would say, on how genre itself functions and how we as viewers react to that genre, and I find that much more interesting than just having redone the same effects over and over again.
So maybe we should have a look at the way you both use the genre movie. First at Thomas' film In the Shadows, a gangster thriller. And we see the scene right after the robbery.
Thank you. 600.000 und ein paar zerquetschte, fast die Hälfte weniger, als Krüger versprochen hat.
Bleiben immer noch 150 Riesen für jeden. Hätte schlimmer kommen können.
Schon ein paar Kilometer auf dem Buckel, fährt aber einwandfrei. Papiere sind im Handschuhfach.
Was kriegst du denn dafür?
Vergiss es. Was hast du jetzt vor?
Verzieh mich erstmal.
In deine Hütte?
Ja. Und du?
Ich werde das mal ein bisschen abwarten, bis Gras über die Sache gewachsen ist. Meine Werkstatt weiterführen. Und dann kaufe ich mir vielleicht ein Häuschen. Spanien oder Türkei. Was Rentner mit Geld eben so machen? Okay, ich werde jetzt mal den Wagen und den Kleinkram entsorgen. Mach's gut, Florian.
Du auch, Nico.
So in that film, Thomas, you really break down the gangster movie into a series of precisely observed movements and actions and gestures.
Yeah, but not because I wanted to deconstruct the genre. I guess that's not necessary anymore. But I try to keep it simple in story-wise, and this gave me a kind of freedom for. Yeah, for other moments. So, as Benjamin said before, it's not in this story. Are not this not these moments are only these moments are important with this functional, which are functional for the story. So otherwise, you could have this kind of tell this robbery in totally different way. There had been long scenes of observation before, and then the robbery, and afterwards more and more scenes what you have to do after a robbery. But this is interesting for me. So you gave me the possibility to show the work,
men at work,
as an all day life work. Of a gangster, so and the haptical elements of it. So and this was interesting for me to make this film. So.
Yeah, what I find interesting also watching your film is the way that it. I always kind of stumble around sentences that I know from gangster movies, and I think that's very interesting. That also the scenes, I have the feeling that I've seen them in a lot of gangster movies. But the way that you depict them and the way the people act is that you can really feel that it's kind of boiled down to the. To the very inner part of genre movies or of gangster thriller, and that's kind of fun for me as a cinema goer that I can go through this film and kind of experience how my own education of genre is depicted in your film. So that's kind of a fun for someone who's seen. Lot of gangster movies, kind of to see how you what you've extracted and how you've put it together in your own view and in your own way of looking at things.
And I think in your own gangster movie, The Robber, you're not so far from that. I mean, you have a completely different rhythm. But when we look at that film, here's the compulsory element, a chase. And but in your interpretation, this compulsory element in your freestyle interpretation becomes pure physical action, really pure physical, pure movement. Would you agree to that?
Yeah, I mean, but from my point of view, it didn't come so much from my wanting to do a certain genre film, but it came more from my work on this figure that the film is about, because he was
about a man who is at the same time a marathon runner and a bank robber.
Right, it's a real figure in Austrian history, and he was a bank robber and a marathon runner at the same time, and he was very good at both of these jobs. And as much as it, I mean, he gathered the money that he got from all the banks, and it was quite a lot, but he never spent it. He just had it under his bed and didn't use it. But it was kind of this, it was about gaining more and more money, and not kind of, it wasn't for the sake of the money, it was for the fun of getting it, you know. That was the same with marathon running. He was very, very extreme training for the marathons, and he still holds a record in a mountain marathon since 25 years in Austria, which tells the story itself. So I had the feeling that, in fact, this guy was about movement and about kind of feeling himself all along. So I had the feeling this is what the film has to bring about. So that's what we're going to look at.
So we're going to see the scene just after the first robbery.
Thank you.
What's so stunning for me is that the scene is so physical, but so reduced to the physical aspect that it becomes abstract in a way, the pure essence of a chase.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's also in the film, it's almost one of the happiest moments of this character. So I think as you can feel this physical presence of him running, and as you can feel the speed and how he kind of lives with it, it's something that you also as a viewer can enjoy a lot. And that's something which I think is the core of action filmmaking, that you can enjoy movement and also the pace and the physicality of the camera and the movement of the characters or whatever it is, cars, whatever.
Want to add something or?
No, I agree totally. So yeah, because it's really it's a core of cinema as well. Of course. Could be a good film as well when people only talking, of course, but then it had to be a physics about the words or the thoughts, and I don't know, but you have to have this element in some way in a cinema, and this is pretty interesting in Benjamin films, I guess, is how he made it.
So already by those short clips, we can see that you don't deconstruct the genre, as you already said, but I think you're really looking for its very essence by reducing it.
Yeah, I always had the dream. I mean, I always thought of, if you don't have 100 million euros to do whatever you like with a budget, then it's always interesting to concentrate yourself on the essence of what you want to depict if you want to have an action scene in a film. So I have the feeling that the essence is that this guy is just fascinating to look at as a runner. I mean, he's just a great runner and he's a great mover, and the way he solves situations is something that is thrilling. And that is something which is in all action films one of the bases of why we find it interesting, because there's someone moving very elegantly through situations and is bigger than life in what he does in our world, in the everyday life that we know. That's why I always enjoy action films much more which have something to do with our world. If it's only, I don't know, extraterrestrials fighting each other, then you don't have a real context. You know, you have the feeling you as a body don't have any connection to the people or the things that are fighting there, which I find mostly quite boring. But if I have action films that really have to do with our everyday life, that could take part in where we live, that's something which I find fascinating. And that's why also this guy is running through places that we know. If we were living in Vienna, you would have seen all these places every day, you know. So it's like he's running through your home or through your living room. So that's something which I kind of found fun to get this action scene in my private life.
So any questions in the audience?
Yeah, you're sort of playing with the most famous movie ever made about Austria, The Third Man, where he's running underneath the sewers, he's up in a Ferris wheel, he's up and down these apartments at a much slower pace, much more deliberate. But there's still the mystery of who this guy is. You got the masked man, and they, Harry Lime, is there, is he real? And I mean, he hit me again. You have to know film history in a certain sense, but it enriches the appreciation of, wow, this is that same place 70 years later. Still trying to get this thing straight.
And for people from Vienna, it's always quite puzzling because the places that are mixed in this action scene don't really have anything to do with each other. You know, you start off in the inner city of Vienna and you go out to the Prater, which is like 2 kilometers away. So it's a little fake in that respect. But maybe one little anecdote. I showed it to Michael Haneke in the time of cutting the film. Because he's always a very good analyzer of if a film has reached the point where it should be. And he said about this scene that he thinks it's too long. He said, you know, normally the scene should be over a minute before it's over now, and he thinks it's too long, it's unproportional. And I think that's that's the exact asset of this scene, that it's too long, you know, that it goes on and on and on, it's running and running, and it gets more and more fun, because you notice that it's something that, as you were saying, is getting abstract. It's not just a function for the film that the scene is there, but it has its own energy, and it goes on, and you kind of enjoy it as it's becoming something different.
I kind of enjoyed the next scene, because we have this running, and then suddenly you have a flat newspaper. And it's really a shock. It's sort of a bummer, in a way.
Yeah, absolutely. And it changes. I mean, as I was saying, it's kind of a happy scene for the character. And then it changes because his girlfriend is reading the newspaper, and she then notices that he's the guy doing these bank robberies. So it becomes very tragic right afterwards. So it's, in a way, a full stop for this feeling as well.
We usually think of genre movies and realistic movies being on opposite sides, or genre and realism being on opposite sides, and genre is the formulaic, or the science fiction, or the in outer space, and realism is something different. And I mean, I think it's easy to say that what both of you do are somewhat realistic genre films, but I was thinking, watching the scenes that that you showed, that one could even go further and say that in your films, genre heightens the sense of realism. So that, especially in your that clip we saw, you know, you're so satisfied with a job well done by professional robbers, right? And at the same time, you know it's going to have to get worse because the genre's in the background. And that somehow puts pressure on the realism of this expertise that you wouldn't have if the genre weren't in the background. And the same thing for the running, that there's something, it's abstract, but it's also... it's just the real aspect of running. It's just the, you know, watching the running, which again is heightened because, of course, there's a genre aspect in the background that we all know. So I'm wondering how you respond to this idea that the genre background actually heightens the realism in your films.
Yeah, I would agree because for me it's always interesting to have characters where. When you have possibilities to show how their life is going on and the work they're doing is of course a very important part as well of their life as well, but it's very hard to make a scene out of it when you're sitting on a computer. Of course, it's very very common kind of work nowadays. But in cinematographic terms, it's more interesting for me as a cinematographer to find something which is more physical, more concrete as well. This is interesting for me to show these kinds of work. And I would agree. To your statement that. At this moment, I'm also on the side of the character, of course. When he's, he did it really, made his job well, and so on. I like to follow him. So,
Yeah, I think for me it's the same thing. I think that's absolutely what I would be aiming at. But I think that's also something that the rest of the Berlin School films that you can see here do. Because I think a lot of it is about heightening reality in the way you look at it. And it's not only a genre thing, but it's also a way of observation itself. And I think that's what many of the films have in common, that they very intensely observe moments of normal life. And that heightens our perception of these moments of normal life that we have ourselves in our lives. So I think that's something special about all of these films, and also that they're kind of they don't judge these moments. Kind of that they're not judgmental in their gaze at reality. They're kind of they seek to be objective. In the way they look, even if it's not possible, but I think that's one wish many of these films have.
In the films that you're doing, there's something else. There's another layer that conflicts with, or you know, is in some tension with this observational stance, and that really changes the way we look.
Absolutely, but that's also one issue that I always had doing these films. Also with Sleeper, my first film, one challenge was kind of to deal with the viewer with his expectations, and because the viewer has all these expectations how a thriller, how an action movie will start and how it'll go on. So I really have to tell him from the first minute on, this is maybe a genre movie, but it's very different to everything you know. So I have to kind of frustrate him in the first 5 minutes so that he doesn't think, you know, it's going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. And because it won't, you know, it'll get bigger, but not as much as you might think. Yeah, that's part of the game and part of also the fun, because I think once you've accepted this frustration, then you can view the film in some different way, which might be richer than just if you go along the line that you watch normally.
As someone who spends a lot of time in Vienna, I have to say you made Vienna far more exciting than it ever is. And I think Michael Haneke's comment to you was probably projection on his part, because he holds the camera always a minute longer than it should be held on certain scenes. So I think it says more about him actually than about your film, because I think the length is perfect. But it's also perfect because of the way you use sound there, right? With the music coming in, which is a heartbeat, which pounds and which comes back at the end of the film. And I was wondering whether that use of sound and that use of music at that point was very deliberate, because you were afraid maybe that it was too long and that there needed to be an added charge or energy.
No, I really wasn't afraid that it was too long. I kind of I saw his point, but I was of a different opinion. But the use of music was a special issue, because we noticed we tried to have a normal score in the beginning, kind of a real film score with orchestra and everything, and we noticed that it's just too too identificational, that for this character, who is really hard to identify with in the beginning, you couldn't use a normal score, because then the viewer would always think he could identify with the character, and then the film wouldn't do that, so you'd be frustrated. So then we came on another musical concept where you have certain just small parts of music that kind of enhance this very moment, and then you go on without music, and then you have source music that are just coming from radios or something that come into the film very harshly and go out very harshly from one scene to another. So it's that was quite a different music concept that I had before, and like that you feel the music much more when it comes, you know, because you're not used to having a normal film score next to the film as you watch it, and then suddenly the film music comes, and that makes the moment even more extreme in a way.
But it's only connected to the story as well. So told us before, and that this moment you have to in some moments of most of the films, I guess you have to lose the hyper realistic ground in some way, and this is a well chosen moment, I guess, because you told us before this is perhaps one of his excited moments in his life, and it's not illustration, but it's a kind of telling it. So
yeah, maybe the most extreme moment is an opera piece which is in the film, in the middle of the film, where the story really tips over and becomes something different. His function for the film vanishes, and it's only this the very moment that I'm in with this screen and the person on screen. And I think that's something, you might call it abstract, but it's also very sensual. And that is something very beautiful about many of these films, that you can have these experiences with the characters, and they're kind of included in the stories, and I think that they don't fall out of the stories. I think that what works with a lot of these films is that you can experience these people inside these stories, and that's something quite unique.
And I think it's not about, because I use the term variation, but at least it's not about to to make something new, something totally different. I'm never thinking about these topics when I'm starting a film. So I'm just trying to explore the scene. What's in it? What is the simplest and the straightest way to tell it? And the most physical in somehow. And this is really difficult, at least to reach this point. And this is a this is a big point for me to find this moment and not to do only something new, something special, and something long shots or short scenes. And this is the most important point for me. So I would agree.
Most of the time, most of the Berlin Schule films I've seen, and I would say most of the characters are not particularly happy characters, possibly not even very fulfilled characters, but we keep talking about them as being realistic films, and I would agree with that notion too. But you know, there is this aspect of happiness and fulfillment. I was wondering how you examine that concept in your films, or choose not to examine it in your films.
I think that's a very good point. That's the aspect of happiness and fun and joy is something that I'm missing in a lot of these films, I must say, also mine. Whereas I think, like for example, longing, Sehnsucht has these aspects. I think there are scenes which I really enjoy, and where I have the feeling it's such a sweet atmosphere with these people, and you can. Yeah, witness people that are in a way, in a very realistic way, joyful. But yeah, in my films, that's why I maybe now made a very strange comedy, because yeah, I was thinking, something has to change.
But even if you try to make a comedy, it's not the point to have happy characters. I guess it's very, very bad for a comedy as well to have happy characters. So
yeah, you might have a look at it and tell me if it worked out or not.
Benjamin and I, we wrote together on many occasions and discussed a lot of film. And one thing that we came back to often was, and what attracted us to genre cinema even before approaching it directly, was this heightened attention to a scene at gunpoint, for example. I mean, if you have two people at gunpoint, you look at them differently. Now, the difficulty or the task would be to have the same heightened attention without the gun. So I remember our fascination with Hitchcock's North by Northwest, the crop duster scene. And I was always wondering, how could we tell the same scene without the crop duster plane, you know? Because it's so beautiful, but in a way, the crop duster plane disturbs me because I don't need a plane firing machine gun. You know, I mean, what I want is a person in the landscape with this intensified look, and so in many of these films, I think you have actually a gunpoint, but you don't see the gun. You know, I mean, that's sort of because what the joy of it is that you see things anew, that you have. You have this estranged view of the everyday life through danger or through this tension. So in a way, I think even better than to have a gun is not to have a gun, but to have the same attention. There's this anecdote about Marlon Brando trying to help his co-actors in close-ups. So he would undress his, he would slip off his pants, so they would be different when they have their own close-ups. So I liked that always. It was such a kind gesture of him to help the other actors. So.
Well, it depends on what was under the pants, you know, if it was kind or not. I don't know. I must say that I would. I don't know if I would like to have the crop duster scene without the crop duster. I kind of like action scenes that with gunpoint, you know. But no, definitely this heightened reality, I think, is something that we were looking for many of us in the films in different ways. And it's interesting to explore in the films how each one of us does it in very different ways. I mean, it's really, the films are very, very different, although they've been put in one box, you know, by critics and other people. But I think that they do it in a very, very different way. And they also have a very different interest in people. I mean, if you look at the way that Valeska in Longing depicts people and the way that I or you depict people, it's quite different, you know. So, I think it's worth watching.
But what you saw today is that they really are entering into some kind of dialogue. We were talking about the precursors before, and you were watching all those genre movies before, but I think Trojan and your hero, the robber, they enter into some kind of dialogue too. I think we saw that today, or we felt it.
Well, we have the same cameraman. That is something. That is a lot in common. And maybe we watch the same movies because of Reinhold, you know, it might be, you know, he... And I think it's fun. I mean, Reinhold and I, we watched, for example, Rambo 1, just because there's these long action sequences through the woods and so on. And it's in a way a very simple movie. And it's in spite of all the you know, content of the movie, these scenes are really nice. And there's a lot of movies in action film history that you can enjoy a lot just for the sake of their action scenes and moving cameras and so on.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you for listening.